cakes and throw in chowder salmon.
Aloha. This special events program is brought to you by the Law Office of Attorney Daphne Barbie and the Office of Attorney Andre Wooten. We hope you enjoy it. Mahalo.
Aloha, Hawaii. I'm Attorney Andre Wooten, and today we're headed over to Maui to give a talk on African American history for the Maui African American Association.
On Maui, February 26th, 2010. To give a Black History Month speech and presentation to the African American Association of Maui.
These are gifts from T. Lay. We have an original Alec Haley first edition, and we have a Malcolm X first edition. But you have to answer two questions, and if you can answer these two questions, you get to have the book. Now, they're easy questions to me being a Christian. I'm working on a book. I'm working on a game called Who Wants to Go to Heaven? And it's like Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? Only the questions are based on scriptures and the Torah. The Torah, the first Bible, the Bible, yes. Okay, so the first question is, you have to ask two questions, it's easy. Who wrote the first five books of the Bible?
Moses.
Yes, okay. Second question, this is a hard one. For the sons of Ruth, the story of Ruth and Naomi, who was Naomi's two sons? She had two sons that passed away because her husband died, and Ruth came along with him and said, your people will be my people. But who were her two sons?
Obadiah.
No, Kehon. I'll give it to you. Kehon and Gihon. Because you got the first one, you get the first one. He is who he is. I'm Mary Wooten.
A special event that has been fought for and earned through long suffering and sacrifice by numerous folks. Certainly, when I was born, I never expected to see a Black president in my lifetime. Barack, having been elected, is bringing back a lot of different memories for different folks. I've always known that my dad was a Tuskegee Airman, because his uniform's still hanging up in my bedroom at my mom's house. But he died when I was 4 months old, so I never really knew him. So imagine my shock and surprise to see that the U.S. Air Force is using his picture on recruiting posters.
Yeah.
I found this out just standing in Porter's bookstore one day years ago, and I turned open ESPN, the magazine, and saw a picture of my dad. And it was shocking because, you know, the government doesn't necessarily ask for permission and stuff like that. So I started looking into why is it that they're posting this picture, and why haven't they contacted the family and this, that, and the other. And it turns out that the picture is in the National Archives. There is a section on the Tuskegee Airmen on the United States website in the National Archives. And this photograph of my dad was taken when he graduated from Tuskegee Airmen School. He wasn't, one of the most decorated of the fighters. But he did fly a fighter over Germany and lived to tell about it. My father's people were brought into Texas as slaves in 1840, brought into the port of Galveston. You know Galveston, old Jack Johnson? You're an old Jack, don't you? Anyway, the folks were marched up the road 200 miles to a place called Crockett, Texas, and sold on the block in front of the county courthouse to some folks that we don't speak of. Because after Juneteenth, and you know the story about Texas. Texas was part of the Confederacy, but not part of the original Confederacy. Anyway, the slave owners of Texas kept the Emancipation Proclamation a secret from the slaves, whom they had, you know, violent power over. And in our family, it's told that after they worked that extra year of slavery, the owners that they had turned them out of the plantation without even allowing them to dig up the potatoes that they had planted. Turned them out with nothing. And so we didn't take that name. The Wooten name that we carry was a European gentleman who assisted them in some way. And I don't really know what that assistance was. But there are pictures of white folks in the family album, at least this white gentleman, that nobody knows who he was or why. And why is he in the family album? But anyway, African-American families generally look like the rainbow. We had a reunion down at the family farm last year, a week after 4th of July. And I can truthfully say we got just about every color, every shade, every corner of the globe is represented in the family these days. But by 1900, my great-grandparents had acquired 500 acres of Texas. And my grandfather, Howard L., went to Prairie View College on a football scholarship in 1910. And he married a lady whom I never met, but who was my grandmother, who was a school teacher. Grandpa went off into World War I and survived that. And he had five children with my grandmother, Johnny C. Morris, whom I never knew because she passed away in childbirth. And then he married another lady, Hiawatha Wooten, with whom he had seven more kids, and she died. And then he married another lady who raised the ones that were still in the home. My father, Howard, also went to Prairie View on a football scholarship, but he dropped out to join up with the Tuskegee Airmen. My grandfather would not sign his papers because of his age or something. He dropped in out anyway, worked his way up to be a sergeant, and then got into the officer's candidate school. And got into the Tuskegee Army Air Corps. So when I met my grandfather, I was 3 years old. My father had died. And I remember one thing he told me. I was 3 years old, and he said, "Boy," and I let him call me boy because I was only 3 years old at the time. He said, "Boy, you will never get rich working for somebody else." And at that time, my grandfather had just retired from 30 years of teaching school. He was the principal of a colored school in Fordyce, Texas, which is a little black town that the ex-slaves established after emancipation. There's a cemetery there that I found out when I was, almost 50, in which there are generations of us going back years and years and years. But when Grandpa died, I was getting to the story. My great-grandparents had 500 acres of Texas in 1900. They had four boys, so each of the boys got 125 acres. When my grandfather died, I think it was 92, he had 12 kids. He left each of them 125 acres. His four brothers I found out also, they didn't have as many kids as he, but they left each of their kids 125 acres of Texas. So in the family now, in that neighborhood, we own about 3,000 acres of Texas. We own that old plantation.
Amen.
I don't know why or how they acquired that original 500 acres, but I know that they've been, you know, turning it over ever since. I was looking at a section of new books, on black whalers. We had a group of black lawyers come visit Honolulu a couple of weeks ago, National Bar Association. My stepfather, after my father died in 1948, my mother remarried when I was two in 1950 to a attorney, one of the few private practicing attorneys in the state of Washington in 1950. In fact, Stokey started practicing in Seattle long about 1938. He got elected to the Washington State Legislature in 1948. And so he always told us that he was the first black man elected to the Washington State Legislature. I believe this because he was my dad, you know. But after I got older and always had this interest in history, Lauren Capps has written a book called The Black West. And he talks about the settlement of the western part of the United States. He talks about the founding of Los Angeles and Pico Rico and the integrated community that started Los Angeles years and years ago. But he also talks about Washington State. Washington State was founded by a black man by the name of George Washington Bush. He financed an integrated settlement wagon train that came up out of New Orleans, Louisiana, long about 1832. When they got to Oregon, they were told that black men could not stay in Oregon more than 6 months because they had what they called black codes, which meant that if they didn't like you and they found that you were there for more than 6 months, it was 30 lashes. So they crossed the river, crossed the Columbia River, and settled in what is now Vancouver, Washington, in the plains of Washington. Now, 10 years later, when they're fighting to establish the boundary of the United States, across the top of the country, that there was a song called 5440 Year Fight and stuff. They used the Bush-Garner settlement to establish the claim for the United States to claim Washington State from the Canadians and or British at the time. Well, that threw Bush back under the jurisdiction of the Oregon Territories for some reason. And his friends, his Caucasian friends who could vote in those days, passed a special exemption through Congress to grant him the same section of land that all of the other settlers at that time were claiming from the Indian lands that was Washington State. So there was a special act of Congress giving Bush a section of land. A section of land is 640 acres. And so George Washington Bush's son Owen Bush was in the very first Washington State Legislature, which convened in 1888. And if you see the pictures, you will see a guy there wearing a beard. His mother, by the way, was Caucasian, so he was a Hapa guy. And it turned out that when I was in law school in the 70s in Seattle, there was a large brother who was 2 years ahead of me. He drove a motorcycle. He turned out to be the great-grandson of George Washington Bush. Even though I didn't know the story in those days, when we were, well, I should say, years ago, we brought Asa Hilliard, a renowned African-American scholar, up from Atlanta, where he was living. Asa passed away about a year ago. But we brought him to Honolulu several times to lecture on African-American history, and certainly the ancient Egyptian history, ancient Kemet. After Asa gave his lecture, it was my honor and privilege to escort him and drive him around, to ask him where he wanted to go. He said he wanted to go to the oldest and best museum in Honolulu. So that's the Bishop's Museum. And in the gallery, in the grand gallery in those days, I noticed that there was a large painting. It was a painting of whalers. And there was the mothership in the distance. In the foreground was a big whale and a little rowboat with six African-American guys in it, with one of them holding this harpoon about to throw into that whaler. The merchant marine of the United States was 50% African-American before the Civil War. And many of those 50% African-Americans were slaves. You know, think about it. If you're a slave owner, you could put your slave on the ship, you get paid, the slave goes out and does the work and stuff. Now, some of those brothers, when they got to Hawaii, they jumped ship. You know, because if it's a matter of going back to slavery in some place, or staying here and hanging out with the Hawaiian girls, well, you know. So, there was a brother named George, there was a brother named Anthony Allen, who was a prominent African-American businessman in Honolulu beginning, he's reported in the newspapers in Honolulu long about 1810, about 10 or 20 years before the missionaries came there. In the newspapers, in the old newspapers in those days. And we have a friend, Miles Jackson. Miles Jackson used to be the head of the library at the University of Hawaii. And he's now retired, but he's now writing books on the history of African Americans in Hawaii. And so some of the stuff that I'm talking about is contained in Miles's books. But Anthony Allen was the president of the African Sailors Relief Association of Hawaii back in 1810. He owned an inn, he owned a dram shop, he owned a bowling alley. And part of his business was in selling provisions to ships when they came in. And the African Relief Association was to nurse back to health, you know, any African American sailors who hit the land who were not in good health. But Allen was reputed to be a road builder and a very prominent man who was hired by the king and a confidant of the king in those days. Also, in early Hawaii history, King Kalakaua III started a band in 1834 that they called the Royal Hawaiian Band because it was a king's band. And lo and behold, he hired an African-American gentleman, America Shattuck, to be the leader of his band and a number of African-American musicians as well. 10 years later, he hired another African-American gentleman, I believe his name was George Wyeth, to be the leader of the Royal Hawaiian Band. Some years ago, I sued the city of Honolulu for refusing to hire an African-American musician as a bassoonist. And after years and years of litigation, and even an appeal to the Ninth Circuit, unfortunately we were not able to prevail in that particular case. But the point is, Honolulu has a band that calls itself the Royal Hawaiian Band, that was originally founded by African-American musicians in 1834 that has not hired an African-American musician full-time in generations. I wanted to show you some photographs from Fiji. This is a video that we shot down in Fiji. And these are some of the kings of Fiji that are on a poster of Fiji. Those photographs were taken about 160 years ago, you know, 150 years ago. But if you look at those guys, that was the thing. When you walk down the streets in Suva or Nandi, I mean, the people you see, they could be your cousins. They look like your cousins or something. And the other thing that I really appreciated about Fiji was that none of the Fijian women put chemicals in their hair or hot combs in their hair. They all wear big, fluffy, really full naturals and stuff because they're proud of who they are and proud of having their own country and their own culture. Now, inside the Fiji Museum, there is a number of exhibits, one of which was a plaque showing their history and where they came from. And in that plaque, which is on one of the videos that I showed, it's even on the cover there, they state that they originally came from Thebes, Egypt. Now, Thebes is a city that's so magnificent it had three different names in three different millenniums. Thebes is the second name of the ancient Kemetic capital of Waset. Waset was called the City of a Thousand Gates. The Grand Temple of Amun-Ra was started by Pharaoh Intep around about 2000 BC. And Senwosre and a number of the other famous pharaohs have talked about that. We show a lot of that history in the videos that we've done about our trips to Egypt. We've been to Egypt a couple of times, and we shoot video like crazy. I got boxes and boxes of photographs that I haven't done anything with because we just been playing with the video, and that's time consuming enough. But if you want a chicken skin experience, I gotta say, going to the Cairo Antiquities Museum was really an eye-opener because you see how the ancient people portrayed themselves. You see how the ancient people had their artists depict themselves. And this is one of the videos that we do. This one is on the history of the African king. And that is in the tomb of Ramses VI. Ramses VI, those guys were 19th dynasty, relatively early. But one of my favorite statues in the Cairo Antiquities Museum was a pharaoh by the name of Amenemhat. Amenemhat lived around 1900 BC, and his statue is in black granite, and I'm talking about black. I mean, it doesn't get any blacker than black granite from Nubia. And his hairdo was rows and rows of neat dreadlocks. In fact, the statue of the pharaoh who built the first pyramid was a guy named Djoser. Djoser was third dynasty, and that's around 2700 BC. He built the step pyramid. His statue was found inside the pyramid years and years ago, and it's been moved to the Cairo Museum for safety. But if you look at his statue, underneath his headdress, he's got neat dreadlocks hanging down. And in many of the statues, some of the noses are there, some of the noses are not. Now, many people want to say that the ancient Egyptians were not African people. Even though Egypt is still in Africa, I know the first time we went to Egypt back in 93, spent a couple of New Years in Egypt I went looking for books, looking for books of Egypt. I'm looking in the Africa section in this bookstore and I said, well, where's the stuff in Egypt? Oh, you gotta go to the Middle East section. They've tried to philosophically remove Egypt from Africa. And the reason for that is that if you remove Egypt from Africa, then you don't have to give Africans credit for inventing civilization. When you go to the pyramids and you look into the history of the pyramids, I mean, the pyramids are the proof that Africans invented math and geometry and architecture. I mean, the pyramid is a proof in stone, and I don't know how many tons it weighs, but it ain't gone nowhere in a long time. They say that Horemaket is the indigenous name for a statue they call a Sphinx. The Sphinx is a Greek name for Horemaket. Now, Horemaket is the symbol of the prince because the sun rises every day over his shoulder. And Horemaket really means Horus on the horizon. Horus is the name of the Egyptian prince. I was about to say, Waset had three names. They gave you two. I gave you one. Wasset became Thebes after Alexander the Great took Egypt from the Persians and the Assyrians. Egypt went through 30 dynasties, the first of which was started by a pharaoh by the name of Narmer-Menes, who came down the River Nile from the south and invaded the Delta area and conquered the king of the Delta, whose name was Abascom. And in the Cairo Antiquities Museum, they have what they call the Palette of Narmer, which memorializes this battle. And that was how the first nation on Earth got built. Before that, there were renowned city-states, but there were no nations. Egypt has the distinction as being the first nation. It consisted of 40 nomes, 40 states. And Narmer-Menes united all of them, and he built his capital at a place called Menifer. The American name for that, anglicized name is Memphis. And you hear the references of Memphis here and there. After about 1,000 years, a general by the name of Amri, an Arab general by the name of Amri, came into Egypt from the north and basically ran the Romans out. Julius Caesar came in and ran the Greeks out along about 30 BC, and pretty much everybody knows the legend of Cleopatra and Mark Antony and Caesar. In many places in the world, there are these Egyptian obelisks, and there's one in Central Park that they call Cleopatra's Needle. There's one that's conceivably the mate to that one that's on the banks of the Thames in London, and we've visited and videoed both of those. But when you read, if you can read, the hieroglyphics, the Medinet, the sacred writing that are on those obelisks, you find that they have nothing to do with Cleopatra. Those obelisks tell the legend of a pharaoh by the name of Thutmose III. Yes. And Thutmose III was the great-grandson of Amosi, who was the husband of Amosi Nefertari, the 18th dynasty of Kemet was one of the most pronounced, because before the 18th dynasty came into play, Egypt had been overrun by a group called the Hyksos. Hyksos basically means the shepherd kings from the north. And for some reason, nobody really wants to say where they came from or who they really were. But around about that time, 1800 BC, was when one first begins to hear references to people called Hebrews and Jewish folks, with the legend of Joseph and the Kochs and this, that, and the other. In any case, Semenkhare was a son of the 17th dynasty, and they decided, the Hyksos really mostly ruled northern Egypt. The indigenous Egyptians still ruled in southern Egypt, and they were still based in Waset, which is called Luxor by the Greeks. And after Amri conquered Egypt in 641 AD, they renamed Thebes Luxor. Luxor is an Arab word meaning city of the palaces. Now, if you haven't been to the Grand Temple of Amun-Ra, I certainly recommend it. Because that's when you begin to see the real history of Africa, the real history of the world. I mean, it's such a magnificent building. It's the oldest and largest temple on the face of the earth. And they built it with such precision that it is just magnificent. I mean, you can walk through the temple, and it's about, it's more than half a mile, maybe a whole mile. But the aisle from the back, you can see straight through to the front door. And across the river from the Grand Temple of Amun-Ra is the Valley of the Kings, where King Tut was buried and where Thutmose III was buried. Now, Thutmose III was the son of Thutmose II, who was the half-brother of Hatshepsut. And Hatshepsut was married to her brother Thutmose II, who died relatively young. And so his son, Thutmose III, was less than 10 years old when his father died. So Hatshepsut became regent of Egypt. Basically, she was the ruler of Egypt, and she is known to have taken on the trappings of the pharaoh. She's known to have worn the false beard, meaning wisdom and power. She's known to have worn the crowns of Egypt. Now, the temple of Hatshepsut is one of the most magnificent temples that still remains in Egypt, over 3,500 years old. It has survived, although earthquakes have taken out the temples of Thutmose III and the temples of many others. But Thutmose III was the so-called Napoleon of Egypt. He extended the boundaries of Egypt to its greatest level. I started mentioning Samunkeri. Samunkeri was a prince of southern Kemet who died fighting the Hyksos. And his younger brother, Kamosi, Samunkeri was the father. He died fighting the Hyksos. Kamosi was the oldest son. He died fighting the Hyksos. After he passed away, the next brother in line, Amosi, he finally defeated the Hyksos and ran the foreigners out of Egypt and consolidated Egyptian local rule in the 18th dynasty. So Nefertari was the sister and wife of Amosi, and she is a very revered personality in ancient Egyptian history. She's frequently painted coal black and with her gold accoutrements and such. Now, Thutmose III would have been maybe the great-grandson of Amosi, Nefertari, and those folks. After Thutmose III passed away, then Amenhotep, his son, Amenhotep the Magnificent, took over. He built many temples in Egypt. And in fact, his statue, along with his wife, is the largest statue in the Cairo Antiquities Museum. Amenhotep the first wife's name, do you remember? Anyway, we have another video that we did on the African queens of Egypt. And that name will come to me because there are statues of her. She's Queen T. There are statues of her in the Cairo Museum that are also magnificent statues in black granite with dreadlocks. And these are some of the things that we show in our videos, because when I was going through school, even a school teacher, my granddad was a school teacher, but none of them showed us these historical facts or showed us any of this information. And the reason for it really is the real history of Egypt contradicts the theory of white supremacy. You know, I mean, because most of what is being taught in Western schools, they want to give the founding of, say, geometry to a Greek guy by the name of Pythagoras. If you read the histories, Pythagoras studied in Egypt for 30 years before he went back to Greece and invented geometry, invented the Pythagorean theorem. But clearly the Egyptians were working on these matters for thousands of years before Greece became a nation. In fact, when you look at much of the history of Egypt, there is a legend that the ancient Egyptians colonized ancient Greece. That's where we get the story of Amenemhat again. They're in the old legend by Homer called the Iliad. There's a battle for Troy, and there's Paris on one side, and Aeneas and various others But there was a Egyptian prince that fought for the Trojan side as well. That name will come to me eventually. I had hoped to be able to show you some illustrations of some of this stuff. But we do have DVDs available for $10. You can call me or connect on the website and we can show you know, some of these facts. Some years ago, we were in London, and you know, we videoed all of the Egyptian Nubian stuff in the British Museum, all of the Egyptian Nubian stuff in the Louvre Museum, and all of that stuff in the Cairo Antiquities Museum. The Luxor Museum, 1,000 miles upriver from Cairo, is also a fantastic museum. And we show the things that we've seen in our videos. We've done a 5-hour series of 5 videos on ancient Kemetic history. That word Kemet, by the way, is the ancient Kemetic word for Egypt. Egypt is a Greek word. The ancient Egyptians did not call themselves Egyptians. The Greeks called the Kemites Egyptians. But the word Kemet is written in the hieroglyphics. It's written in the pictographs. And the symbols are a lump of coal and a man. And so it literally means black man's land, Kemet. Kem is the root to the word chemistry. The Egyptians were the first to invent the accurate modern calendar. And in order to calibrate a calendar accurately, you have to study the Sirius star, there's a star, the dog star Sirius, for 34 or 3200 years. Which is an indication of how scholarly they were, how studious they were, and that goes hand in hand with the proof of their invention of mathematics, which the pyramids are, and the temples, which are lined up and down the Nile. It's really astounding. I mean, if you've been to, say, New York City and to the Metropolitan Museum in New York, they have a fantastic Egyptian collection there as well. And so, after visiting some of these museums, I mean, there are museums all through Europe that I haven't visited that have whole wings that are dedicated toward ancient Egyptian materials. So it's really quite astounding that there's so much left in Egypt when you see what's been taken out of Egypt. But then you have to consider that Egypt was a nation for at least 3,000 years as an independent sovereign entity. If you go back to the founding of the first dynasty by Narmer-Menes, long about 3200 BC, and some say that was more like 5000 BC, but conservatively, it was at least 3200 BC. And then going through the different dynasties until you come to the 30th dynasty, the last ruler of which was Cleopatra. But I find it really, not even curious, but really nefarious, that the obelisk of Thutmose III, the Napoleon of Egypt, they are called Cleopatra's Needles in many places around the world. And it's like hiding something in plain sight. You know, people are saying there's no history of African civilization. Well, what do you think these obelisks are? There's an obelisk in the Vatican Center over there. There's an obelisk in Rome. When you come out of the Louvre in Paris, they've got an obelisk and they've got it dressed. That was interesting. In the ancient obelisk was a symbol. The Egyptians were so symbolic. The ancient obelisk was a symbol of many things. One of which was rays of the sun. They were said to be sun worshippers. And so the needles were said to be needles of the sun, and they used to dress the top of the needles with a combination of gold and silver called electrum, so that when the sun hit it, it shone for miles and miles. You know, the other rationale for the obelisk symbol is the history of the legend of Isis and Osiris. Osiris was the first king, first pharaoh of Egypt in the legendary days. His wife was his sister, Isis. And Osiris is said to have invented agriculture. He's said to have invented the fermenting of wine. He's said to have stopped people from cannibalism. He's basically said to be the civilizer. And after he civilized Kemet, he decided to take a trip around the then known world and start civilizing the rest of the world. So he and his entourage went on a trip here and there. And then when he came back, he had a brother. His brother's name was Seth. And as he was entering northern Egyptian territory, Seth threw a party for him. Welcome back, brother. Glad to see you. We missed you. Blah, 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 blah. And I'm just glad to relinquish the ruling the country. Glad you're back. Well, he presented Osiris with a chest and said, if the chest fits you, once you get in it, then of course you can have it. Well, Osiris laid down in the chest, Seth threw the cover down, and stabbed him and killed him. And it's said that he carved his body up in 14 different pieces. Well, eventually, his wife, Isis, heard about this, and she was very upset. And she sprouted wings and went looking for the pieces of her husband. And it's said that she found 13 pieces and put them back together. The one piece she couldn't find was his penis. Nevertheless, she bore a son who was called Horus. And according to the legends, she had to hide Horus from Set because by now everybody knew Set was a killer. I mean, he wanted to be the king, and that's why he killed his brother who was the king. And so Isis hid Horus until he became a man, and then he went looking for his uncle. And in the temple of Edfu, south of Luxor, south of Waset Kemet, but north of Aswan, there's a temple called Edfu, and the legend of Osiris, Horus, and Set is carved there in stone. And so after Horus caught up with Set, they fought, and eventually he subdued him, took his eye out, but didn't kill him, supposedly. Set is memorialized in the Kemetic pantheon of gods with a donkey's head. And it's basically the symbol of not necessarily evil, but the contrary way of doing things. You know, it's like, you know, jackass philosophy, you know. Because in the ancient Egyptian pantheon and morality, all elements of the human personality were represented one way or another. Horus is symbolized by the falcon. The falcon symbolized the prince who eventually becomes the king. And so that's why you see these bird-headed figures in Egypt. The other part of the Egyptian pantheon that really lit me up inspirationally was learning about the history of Tahuti, Toth. Toth in the Egyptian pantheon is a figure that you see with a crane's head, and frequently he has a tablet and a scribe. Toth was the god of wisdom. He was the inventor of books, the guardian of the language. And when I realized that there was an African god of wisdom that nobody ever told me about, it was really, you know, quite a revelation, you know. It's interesting that many of the ancient philosophers say that the Greeks adopted their pantheon of gods from the ancient Kemites. Like Zeus was Osiris, the king of the gods. Actually, I'll get back to this legend, because according to the legend, after Horus was born, Osiris became alive for a while, but he, I don't know, something had changed in him, and he couldn't deal with it. But Osiris eventually became the god of the underworld. And Osiris had a son called Anubis, and Anubis is symboled by the dog's head. So in murals and paintings all up and down the Nile, the judgment of Osiris is a common theme that you've seen. And I've taken it as my card, actually. We had a painting done of this. Let me just pass this around. That symbol of the judgment of Osiris is all up and down the Nile River, you know, into Nubia. I mean, it was not just an Egyptian thing, but that was the Nilotic civilization. In that symbol, you've got the African god Osiris wearing a white robe, sitting on the judge's seat. In the front of the symbol, there is a scale. And on that scale, according to legend, the newly deceased person's heart would be weighed opposite a feather. And if your heart was as light as a feather, you would be passed into everlasting life. And if your heart was heavier than a feather, you were eaten by the monster and denied eternity. Curiously enough, in that symbol, and on top of the painting is 14 Egyptian gods as the jury. So when I saw that painting, the Egyptian lawyer wearing dreadlocks, escorting the newly deceased person to have his heart weighed on the feather, it's the first and oldest depiction of the of a judicial process that I've ever seen, and it goes back 4,000 years, which is why I adopted that. Before that, I used to use the blind symbol of Greek justice, basically, until I found the scale on which her symbol was based. Is there anything anybody wants to ask me any questions about?
Sure.
I'm not sure. There are places that we want to go, places that we haven't been. I want to go to Abydos, for one thing. Luxor was the burial ground of what they call the Middle Kingdom and the New Kingdom. The Middle Kingdom, I mentioned Amenemhat and Senwosre and the Entefs. Those were the leaders of the Middle Kingdom who reestablished unified rule of Egypt after the 9th dynasty of the Old Kingdom collapsed long about 2100 BC. There was a period of dissension, a period when there was no central rule. There was a period of warfare. It's curious because during that period, the quality of the artwork went down. It became more primitive during that period. And then after the then again, kings, the Inteps and Senwosre and all those guys, they came down from the south again and reconquered the north and unified the country again from the south.
Can you talk about the how the plaque, the linguistics, when she decided the Fijian plaque, when it wasn't deciphered till the late 90s, the linguistic, and the Fijian plaque, because they didn't know, well, what is this plaque from? And when he explained it to me and I saw the video, I'm like, oh my God, it's actually written, you know, the plaque states it, but they didn't decipher it.
What I heard and what we wrote, I mean, there's some verbiage, you know, next to the charts that are in the Fiji Museum. And basically what they said was that according to their oldest oral history, they originally came from Thebes, Egypt. And it's curious that you find that same story repeated in a number of different places around the world. The story is that they exited Egypt by going south, which implies to me that Egypt may have been being invaded from the north, and we just don't know which invasion that was. Egypt was invaded many times. I mean, there were the Hyksos in around 1800. There were the Assyrians, Ashurbanipal, and boy, there was Darius of the Persians. And then, of course, Alexander the Great, and then Julius Caesar, and then Amri. So at any point in time when your country's being invaded and you don't think your army's going to hold, well, you can stay or you can ease on down the road. And, you know, I do believe that, you know, smart people get out of the way of obliteration sometimes.
So then do you believe then that the Egyptians, by coming from Egypt down into the Melanesian Sea to feed into Samoa and eventually to Hawaii, where we have the African connection as the central sea of the early Hawaiians?
Well, certainly according to that plaque in Fiji, they say that some Fijians continued their migration and wound up in Hawaii. Hawaii is very curious because even the legend of the Tahitians and the Tongans who came into Hawaii maybe about 1500 years ago say that there were little brown people here when they got here, and those people were called the Minahunis. It's almost like the leprechauns of Ireland and such. But if you go to Kauai, if you go to the Big Island, there are places that they say the Minahunis built. And they talk about the fact that the Minahunis were overrun, either killed, conquered, and or enslaved by the Tahitians and the Polynesians that came up later in a subsequent wave of migration. When we were, we had the good fortune to visit South Africa in 2004. Wanted to see how South Africa was doing after apartheid ended. And it was really quite fascinating. There was a feeling kind of like the wild, wild west in terms of, you know, things are possible here. I mean, with the right situation, one could do some serious business and do some serious damage. I mean, we went with the NBA, National Black Lawyers Association. And consequently, we got a tour of the new South African Supreme Court, which is built on the grounds of Number 5 Prison. And Number 5 Prison was a big prison that sat on a hill overlooking Johannesburg, where they beat Steve Biko down and a bunch of other people. And the cell in the health department where they kept Nelson Mandela is now a national museum and treasure. There's a video going on when you walk in there and stuff like that. And we had lunch up there with some of the Supreme Court justices of South Africa. And they were explaining that they built the Supreme Court on the grounds of this old black prison so that people won't forget what justice is supposed to be all about. The building is just really magnificent, and we have that on video too. I didn't bring that one, but we do have that one if folks want to see it. When we were leaving, was one experience we had in South Africa, we tell folks about. The president of the Black Lawyers Association in 04, Clyde Bailey, he's unfortunately passed away now. He was an attorney for Kodak, but his wife is a professor at Howard University, and she knew a prince from Africa. Unfortunately, the prince had died, but his mother and his little brother, who became the king of the Bafa King, invited us down for lunch and threw us a heck of a party. The Bafa King story is that they were a small clan of people. I think these days there might be 300,000 of them or so. And when the Boers took over about 120 years ago, it became illegal for black men to own titles to their land. And so the king of the Bafa king sent his army into the mines. And when they came back, they each threw 50% into the communal pot. And they began to buy back their land using Lutheran missionaries as intermediaries to hold the title. 100 years later, the law changes, and it's now legal for black men to hold title to their lands. And so these Lutheran missionaries transferred title to 300 hectares of land back to the tribe. Now, if you look at a hectare is 8 acres. So 300,000 times 8, we'll talk about, 24,000 acres or whatever. And underneath that land is the second largest platinum mine in the world. So the Bafa king used to have their tribal meetings under this big baobab tree. And the baobab tree is still there. But next to the baobab tree is a modern 8-story brick office building with modern computers and their administrative center. Next to that is a 5,000-seat opera house. Down the road is an 80,000-seat football stadium. You know, the World Cup is in South Africa this year, and the Bafa king got a stadium ready for them. And they're going to be playing soccer over there. So there are a lot of people in South Africa trying to join this tribe because the task of their tribal commission is to figure out what to do with the $250 million in royalties they get from the platinum mine every year to diversify for the time when the platinum runs out and stuff. But the king of the Bafa king, he's 35 years old, and this brother's living large. Yes?
Getting back to the pyramids, I've been listening to a lot of late-night talk shows where people allege that the pyramids were actually created by extraterrestrials and that they have some connection to outer space. Heard any of that? What is your view of that?
Oh, sure, you hear it. I mean, there have been movies about that. And, you know, if somebody's going to spend $10, $20 million on a fantasy movie, I mean, you know, we believe in free speech and things of that nature. All we can do is try to tell the truth. All we can do is try to show the truth. And that's why we've gone to Egypt and videoed what we see so that we can show you what we see with our own eyes. Because many of the times when you look at historical presentations on Africa, there was one presentation that I really take issue with. Henry Louis Gates, chairman of the Black Studies program over at Harvard, did a mini-series on African history, but he didn't talk about Egypt. He flew into Egypt, but he didn't go to the Cairo Museum, where it's all laid out for you, and then he's talking about nobody knows where the Egyptians come from, and probably the Egyptians know where they came from. The Egyptians know who invaded them and who was there originally. You know, poetic license is being taken. I mean, there are stories that the pyramids were built by slaves. There are stories that the pyramids were built by Jewish slaves. However, if you look at the chronology, the first pyramid, the Step Pyramid, was built around about 2700 BC, maybe 2750. Most of the pyramids were built during the 4th dynasty by Khufu, Menkaure, Cheops. And so the old kingdom died, and the first intermediate period happened around about maybe 2100 BC. So I'm saying that the most robust pyramid building period of Egypt was between about 2700 BC up to maybe 2300 BC. The first Hebrew that appears on any historical document is more like 1700 BC. The story of Moses, by the way, is not something that's written up in any of the ancient Egyptian papyruses or carved in stone. At the time in which Moses is supposed to live, there is a widespread Egyptian story about Thutmose IV, who changed his name to Akhenaten. And Akhenaten was the son of Amenhotep III and Queen Ti. His father ruled Egypt for about 60 years, and it was a magnificent and very prominent and profitable empire. Akhenaten decided to change the religion, and he is said to have been the first monotheist pharaoh. He worshipped the sun, but he wanted to do away with all the other Egyptian gods. Well, this didn't really please the religious establishment, because in changing the gods, you're messing with their power source. And so Akhenaten was the son of the pharaoh, and he created his own city outside of Thutmose, outside of Waset. It's said that he was murdered, basically. At that time, there are legends in Egypt of the people who were religious followers of Akhenaten exiting Egypt and moving north. And so that somewhat corresponds to the legend of Hebrews heading out of Egypt, but the Egyptian story has different personalities and different reasons for it.
Well, that was the key at the Egypt Museum. The tour guide showed us, I guess, the mummified remains of a pharaoh who was supposedly the one that was involved with Moses. And he said, from analysis of this mummy, they determined that it drowned.
That it drowned?
That it drowned. So there's some confirmation of the story. I was wondering if you had run into that at all.
I didn't have that tour guide. I do have videos of the sarcophagus of Akhenaten and videos of various statues of Akhenaten.
What's his time period?
Akhenaten would have been around 1200 BC. Around 1200 BC. Akhenaten, it is said, in the news last week, they were saying they did a DNA study of King Tut, and they say that King Tut was Akhenaten's son. Tut was the last pharaoh of the 18th dynasty. After Tut died, Horemheb, who was the general of the 18th dynasty, became pharaoh. And then after Horemheb died, Ramses, the first father, oh boy, his name starts with an S, he took over. And then, so the 19th dynasty was around 1890. Ramses the second, he ruled for about 60 years. He's said to have had maybe 150 wives. In fact, his nickname was Ramses, basically. But he was a great builder and such. And he built fantastic temples at Abu Simbel. Abu Simbel is in southern Egypt. And Abu Simbel was considered to be kind of the gateway to Nubia. And his paramount wife, Nefertari, also had a temple built to her across the way from Ramses II's bigger temple. And it is said that she was a Nubian princess, and these temples were built to impress her relatives and her people. In ancient days, the pyramids and the temples were considered to be, to a certain extent, propaganda. You know, it's basically showing, I'm here, you know, I'm building things, and when I die, I will still be standing.
What do you make of the Sphinx?
It's a beautiful statue. And when you actually go there and see it close up, you can see that some of the paint is still on his cheeks. There are legends. The Sphinx is supposed to be around 2,500 years old, but some say because they found seashells embedded in the Sphinx's shoulders, that it had to have been during the period when, before the Delta dried out. And so some say the Sphinx is 10,000 years old. But I look at the Sphinx as kind of like a gateway to Egypt, and also as a calling card, you know, saying that we're here, and if you look at the Sphinx, I don't think one could legitimately assume or guess that he was anything other than an African man.
Because did you see inscriptions between the toes?
I did not see inscriptions between the toes. There is a stela between his paws, and they say that is the dream stela. They say that the Masons, as part of their ancient initiation rites, had to memorize and touch the dream stela. It's said that Jesus Christ was indoctrinated into the Egyptian mystery system and had touched the dream stela of Horemaket.
Excuse me, Andre, we so love everything that you're letting us know. We're so filled up with all your wonderful information. But I have to ask for just one more question, and then we need to bring it to a close.
Everything must come to an end.
One more question, so make it good. You don't get to see him too often, okay? Make it good. Somebody wasn't asked.
Oh.
Okay, good.
I like this. That's one.
Okay, come on.
The Sphinx, I always said this. Now, I hope, I think I'm right. When they lopped off the nose, I'm thinking they lopped off the nose because they didn't want anyone to know it was us.
Oh, certainly, 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 certainly. There are two different legends that I encountered about how the Sphinx lost his nose. The first legend was that Arabs shot off the nose of the Sphinx because they wanted to symbolize to the indigenous Kemetic people that they were out of power. The other legend is that when Napoleon Bonaparte attacked and jumped Egypt in 1798. And it is said that his soldiers shot the nose off the Sphinx then. The history of Egypt just goes on fascinating. Because after 1800, we get to a guy called Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali was a Turkish general who was sent by the caliph to take Egypt back from the Mamelukes. And the Mamelukes were slave men that the Arab armies had captured as children and then turned into warriors. Well, after Saladin died, after beating Richard the Lionheart, these warrior slaves cut the caliph of Egypt's throat, and the Mamelukes ran Egypt for several centuries. And so eventually the Arab caliphs sent Muhammad Ali to round them up, and that's a whole other story, which is fascinating. But
you said there are...
Aloha. This program is brought to you by the Law Office of Attorney Daphne Barbie and the Office of Attorney Andre Wooten. We hope you enjoy it. Mahalo.